Chapter 1 of Closing In, Marines in the Seizure of Iwo Jima. Closing In, Marines in the Seizure of Iwo Jima by Joseph H. Alexander. Sunday 4 March 1945 marked the end of the second week of the U.S. invasion of Iwo Jima. By this point, the assault elements of the 3rd, 4th, and 5th Marine Divisions were exhausted, their combat efficiency reduced to dangerously low levels. The thrilling sight of the American flag being raised by the 28th Marines on Mount Suribachi had occurred 10 days earlier, a lifetime on Sulphur Island. The landing forces of the 5 Amphibious Corps, VAC, had already sustained 13,000 casualties, including 3,000 dead. The front lines were a jagged serration across Iwo's fat northern half, still in the middle of the main Japanese defenses. Ahead, the going seemed all uphill against a well-disciplined, rarely visible enemy. In the center of the island, the 3rd Marine Division units had been up most of the night repelling a small but determined Japanese counterattack, which had found the seam between the 21st and 9th Marines. Vicious close combat had cost both sides heavy casualties. The counterattack spoiled the division's preparations for a morning advance. Both regiments made marginal gains against very stiff opposition. To the east, the 4th Marine Division had finally captured Hill 382, ending its long exposure in the amphitheater, but combat efficiency had fallen to 50%. It would drop another 5 points by nightfall. On this day, the 24th Marines, supported by flame tanks, advanced a total of 100 yards, pausing to detonate more than a ton of explosives against enemy cave positions in that sector. The 23rd and 25th Marines entered the most difficult terrain yet encountered, broken ground that limited visibility to only a few feet. Along the western flank, the 5th Marine Division had just seized Nishi Ridge and Hill 362B the previous day, suffering more than 500 casualties. It too had been up most of the night engaging a sizable force of infiltrators. The Sunday morning attacks lacked coordination, reflecting the division's collective exhaustion. Most rifle companies were at half strength. The net gain for the day, the division reported, was practically nil. But the battle was beginning to take its toll on the Japanese garrison as well. General Tadamichi Kuribayashi knew his 109th Division had inflicted heavy casualties on the attacking Marines, yet his own losses had been comparable. The American capture of the key hills in the main defense sector the day before deprived him of his invaluable artillery observation sights. His brilliant chief of artillery, Colonel Chosaku Kaido, lay dying. On this date, Kuribayashi moved his own command post from the central highlands to a large cave on the northwest coast. The usual blandishments from Imperial General Headquarters in Tokyo reached him by radio that afternoon. But Kuribayashi was in no mood for heroic rhetoric. "Send me air and naval support, and I will hold the island," he signaled. "Without them, I cannot hold." That afternoon, the fighting men of both sides witnessed a harbinger of Iwo Jima's fate. Through the overcast skies appeared a gigantic silver bomber, the largest aircraft anyone had ever seen. It was the Boeing B-29 Superfortress, Dynamite, crippled in a raid over Tokyo, seeking an emergency landing on the island's scruffy main airstrip. As the Americans in the vicinity held their breaths, the big bomber swooped in from the south, landed heavily, clipped a field telephone pole with a wing, and shuddered to a stop less than 50 feet from the bitter end of the strip. Pilot Lieutenant Fred Mallow and his 10-man crew were extremely glad to be alive, but they didn't stay long. Every Japanese gunner within range wanted to bag this prize. Mechanics made field repairs within a half hour. Then the 65-ton Superfort lumbered aloft through a hail of enemy fire and headed back to its base in Tinian. The Marines cheered. The Battle of Iwo Jima would rage on for another 22 days, claiming 11,000 more American casualties and the lives of virtually the entire Japanese garrison. This was a colossal fight between two well-armed, veteran forces, the biggest and bloodiest battle in the history of the United States Marine Corps. From the 4th of March on, however, the leaders of both sides entertained no doubts as to the ultimate outcome. End of Chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of Closing In, Marines in the Seizure of Iwo Jima, by Joseph H. Alexander. Assault Preparations. Iwo Jima was one of those rare amphibious landings where the assault troops could clearly see the value of the objective. They were the first ground units to approach within 1,000 miles of the Japanese homeland, and they were participating directly in the support of the strategic bombing campaign. The latter element represented a new wrinkle on an old theme. For 40 years, the U.S. Marines had been developing the capability for seizing advanced naval bases in support of the fleet. Increasingly in the Pacific War, and most especially at Saipan, Tinian, and now Iwo Jima, they were seizing advanced air bases to further the strategic bombing of the Japanese home islands. American servicemen had awaited the coming of the B-29s for years. The very long-range bombers, which had become operational too late for the European War, had been striking mainland Japan since November 1944. Results proved disappointing. The problem stemmed not from the pilots or planes, but rather from a vexing little spit of volcanic rock lying halfway along the direct path from Saipan to Tokyo, Iwo Jima. Iwo's radar gave the Japanese defense authorities 2 hours advance notice of every B-29 strike. Japanese fighters based on Iwo swarmed up to harass the unescorted superforts going in and especially coming home, picking off those bombers crippled by anti-aircraft, AA, fire. As a result, the B-29s had to fly higher along circuitous routes with a reduced payload. At the same time, enemy bombers based on Iwo often raided B-29 bases in the Marianas, causing some damage. The Joint Chiefs of Staff decided Iwo Jima must be captured and a U.S. airbase built there. This would eliminate Japanese bombing raids and the early warning interceptions, provide fighter escorts throughout the most dangerous portion of the long B-29 missions, and enable greater payloads at longer ranges. Iwo Jima in American hands would also provide a welcome emergency field for crippled B-29s returning from Tokyo. It would also protect the flank of the pending invasion of Okinawa. In October 1944, the Joint Chiefs directed Fleet Admiral Chester W. Nimitz, Sink Pack, to seize and develop Iwo Jima within the ensuing 3 months. This launched Operation Detachment. The first enemy in the campaign would prove to be the island itself, an ugly, barren, foul-smelling chunk of volcanic sand and rock, barely 10 square miles in size. Iwo Jima means Sulphur Island in Japanese. As described by one Imperial Army staff officer, the place was an island of sulfur, no water, no sparrow, no swallow. Less poetic American officers saw Iwo's resemblance to a pork chop, with the 556-foot dormant volcano Mount Suribachi dominating the narrow southern end, overlooking the only potential landing beaches. To the north, the land rose unevenly onto Motoyama Plateau, falling off sharply along the coasts into steep cliffs and canyons. The terrain in the north represented a defender's dream. Broken, convoluted, cave-dotted, a jungle of stone. Wreathed by volcanic steam, the twisted landscape appeared ungodly, almost moon-like. More than one surviving Marine compared the island to something out of Dante's Inferno. Forbidding Iwo Jima had two redeeming features in 1945. The military value of its airfields and the psychological status of the island as a historical possession of Japan. Iwo Jima lay in Japan's inner vital defense zone and was in fact administered as part of the Tokyo Prefecture. In the words of one Japanese officer, Iwo Jima is the doorkeeper to the imperial capital. Even by the slowest aircraft, Tokyo could be reached in 3 flight hours from Iwo. In the battle for Iwo Jima, a total of 28,000 Americans and Japanese would give their lives in savage fighting during the last winter months of 1945. No one on the American side ever suggested that taking Iwo Jima would be an easy proposition. Admiral Nimitz assigned this mission to the same team which had prevailed so effectively in the earlier amphibious assaults in the Gilberts, Marshalls, and Marianas, Admiral Raymond A. Spruance, commanding the 5th Fleet, Vice Admiral Richmond Kelly Turner, commanding the Expeditionary Forces, and Rear Admiral Harry W. Hill, commanding the Attack Force. Spruance added the highly regarded Rear Admiral William H. P. Blandy, a veteran of the Peleliu-Angaur landings, to command the Amphibious Support Forces, responsible for minesweeping, underwater demolition team operations, and preliminary naval air and gun bombardment. As usual, maintaining unremitting military pressure on the enemy meant an accelerated planning schedule and an overriding emphasis on speed of execution. The amphibious task force preparing to assault Iwo Jima soon found itself squeezed on both ends. Hill and Blandy had a critical need for the amphibious ships, landing craft, and shore bombardment vessels currently being used by General Douglas MacArthur in his reconquest of Luzon in the Philippines. But bad weather and stiff enemy resistance combined to delay completion of that operation. The Joint Chiefs reluctantly postponed D-Day for Iwo Jima from 20 January 1945 until 19 February. The tail end of the schedule provided no relief.
D-Day for Okinawa could go no later than 1 April because of the approach of the monsoon season. The constricted time frame for Iwo would have grave implications for the landing force.
The experienced 5 Amphibious Corps under Major General Harry Schmidt, USMC, would provide the landing force an unprecedented assembly of 3 Marine divisions, the 3rd, 4th, and 5th. Schmidt would have the distinction of commanding the largest force of U.S. Marines ever committed in a single battle, a combined force which eventually totaled more than 80,000 men. Well above half of these Marines were veterans of earlier fighting in the Pacific. Realistic training had prepared the newcomers well. The troops assaulting Iwo Jima were arguably the most proficient amphibious forces the world had seen. Unfortunately, 2 senior Marines shared the limelight for the Iwo Jima battle, and history has often done both an injustice. Spruance and Turner prevailed upon Lieutenant General Holland M. Smith, then commanding Fleet Marine Forces Pacific, to participate in Operation Detachment as commanding general, expeditionary troops. This was a gratuitous billet. Schmidt had the rank, experience, staff, and resources to execute corps-level responsibility without being second-guessed by another headquarters. Smith, the amphibious pioneer and veteran of landings in the Aleutians, Gilberts, Marshalls, and Marianas, admitted to being embarrassed by the assignment. "My son had almost set by then," he stated. "I think they asked me along only in case something happened to Harry Schmidt." Smith tried to keep out of Schmidt's way, but his subsequent decision to withhold commitment of the 3rd Marines, the Expeditionary Troops Reserve, remains as controversial today as it was in 1945. Holland Smith was an undeniable asset to the Iwo Jima campaign. During the top-level planning stage, he was often, as always, a voice in the wilderness, predicting severe casualties unless greater and more effective preliminary naval bombardment was provided. He diverted the press and the visiting dignitaries from Schmidt, always providing realistic counterpoints to some of the rosier staff estimates. "It's a tough proposition," Smith would say about Iwo. "That's why we are here." General Schmidt, whose few public pronouncements left him saddled with the unfortunate prediction of a 10-day conquest of Iwo Jima, came to resent the perceived role Holland Smith played in post-war accounts, as he would forcibly state, "I was the commander of all troops on Iwo Jima at all times. Holland Smith never had a command post ashore, never issued a single order ashore, never spent a single night ashore. Isn't it important from an historical standpoint that I commanded the greatest number of Marines ever to be engaged in a single action in the entire history of the Marine Corps?" General Smith would not disagree with those points. Smith provided a useful role, but Schmidt and his exceptional staff deserve maximum credit for planning and executing the difficult and bloody battle of Iwo Jima. The 5 Amphibious Corps achievement was made even more memorable by the enormously difficult opposition provided by the island and the enemy. In Lieutenant General Tadamichi Kuribayashi, see sidebar, the Americans faced one of the most formidable opponents of the war. A 5th-generation samurai, handpicked and personally extolled by the emperor, Kuribayashi combined combat experience with an innovative mind and an iron will. Although this would be his only combat against American forces, he had learned much about his prospective opponents from earlier service in the United States. More significantly, he could appraise with an unblinking eye the results of previous Japanese attempts to repel American invasions of Japanese-held garrisons. Heroic rhetoric aside, Kuribayashi saw little to commend the defend-at-the-water's-edge tactics and all-or-nothing bonsai attacks which had characterized Japan's failures from Tarawa to Tinian. Kuribayashi, a realist, also knew not to expect much help from Japan's depleted fleet and air forces. His best chances, he concluded, would be to maximize Iwo's forbidding terrain with a defense in depth along the pattern of the recent Byak and Peleliu defensive efforts. He would eschew coast defense, anti-landing, and bonsai tactics and instead conduct a prolonged battle of attrition, a war of nerves, patience, and time. Possibly the Americans would lose heart and abandon the campaign. Such a seemingly passive policy, even that late in the war, seemed revolutionary to senior Japanese Army and Navy leaders. It ran counter to the deeply ingrained warrior code, which viewed the defensive as only an unpleasant interim pending resumption of the glorious offensive in which one could destroy the enemy with sword and bayonet. Even Imperial General Headquarters grew nervous. There is some evidence of a top-level request for guidance in defending against American storm landings from Nazi Germany, whose sad experience in trying to defend Normandy at the water's edge had proven disastrous. The Japanese remained unconvinced. Kuribayashi needed every bit of his top connections with the emperor to keep from being summarily relieved for his radical proposals. His was not a complete organizational victory. The Navy insisted on building gun casemates and blockhouses along the obvious landing beaches on Iwo, but in general he prevailed. Kuribayashi demanded the assistance of the finest mining engineers and fortification specialists in the empire. Here again, the island favored the defender. Iwo's volcanic sand mixed readily with cement to produce superior concrete for installations. The soft rock lent itself to rapid digging. Half the garrison lay aside their weapons to labor with pick and spade. When American heavy bombers from the 7th Air Force commenced a daily pounding of the island in early December 1944, Kuribayashi simply moved everything. Weapons, command posts, barracks, aid stations, underground. These engineering achievements were remarkable. Masked gun positions provided interlocking fields of fire. Miles of tunnels linked key defensive positions. Every cave featured multiple outlets and ventilation tubes. One installation inside Mount...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.